Hello altogether, Boomkrach calling, and welcome to the second part of my series of Dilophosites and the Dilophosites project basically. And today I want to focus on spin 1/2 Dilophosites for Earths. And for that purpose I want to start my slides here and then here. Alright, why spin 1/2s? Yes. The first point is this question, because something has to be good at spin 1/2, and that is basically at the first point that there the possible spin on excitations occur, because they also have a spin of 1/2. And secondly, if you can see here, in this point we have something with up and down, and this possibly works perfectly at 1/2. And maybe if you have higher moments, then we have some other effects, and that's maybe not so the clearest effect then in the end. And therefore, the first idea was to use spin 1/2s. And that are here the series of the lanthanides, cerium and ytterbium. No, cer. Cer is the word. Cer and ytterbium. They have spins of 1/2, and then some orbital momentum, and then a resulting momentum, as you can see here. So spin of 1/2, and that is interesting. And I want to present you two different materials, and one has a antiferromagnetic ground state and one has a quantum spin liquid ground state, because as you know, that are the two basic possibilities here in these materials. So I want to start with the first one, and this is sodium ytterbium sulfide, and I basically want to refer on these two papers here. And the first measurement which I want to show you is the susceptibility, and that was at first point quite interesting, because they measured in two different orientations, in plane and out of plane, and they found starting at 80 Kelvin there is some anisotropy. You can see here two twigs, and an anisotropy starts here at 80 Kelvin. And then we can see here behaviors in the case of in-plane. We have then behaviors that we have such a bending here. So first we can see here in the middle picture, we have here a bending to the bottom. And here we have also something that something drops there at these points. But that this is not a transition, there just the effective moment gets lower. Because if we have a higher slope, then the effective moment is dropped. That's because we have 1 over chi plotted here on these two pictures at the right, and on the left we have just the chi, chi, and that's the point. But what we basically can see that we have no transition here, because if we would have antiferromagnetic things, then the behavior would be different, and it's also measured down to a very low temperature, I think 20 millikelvin or 200 millikelvin, what was the case here. And they didn't found something, but some low spin state emerges here, and that is kind of a hint that we have something like a quantum spin liquid possibly, because there we have just a spin moment, just a spin moment is necessary for, or it's just the spin moment there which lives, and this is something here the case with these effective moments. And second thing which they what they did was specific heat. Specific heat is every time a very interesting thing, because you can see different things. You can see the transition in a very good shape, but also if you have other kinds of magnetic stuff or excitations, then specific heat is a very interesting method. And they did a first measurement with the unmagnetic sodium lutetium sulfide, and then they did a minus and found the magnetic part. And the magnetic part is here shaded in blue on the right. And there you can see something like a peak. But they analyzed Schottky, and it wasn't a Schottky peak, but it was also not a transition peak. And they said it's something like short range order, which also hints a quantum spin liquid at this point. And here they found also that this is at 800 millikelvin approximately, and then they also calculated the entropy, and entropy have to reach RLN2 in this case, because we have spin 1/2 and 2s plus 1 is 2 in this case for 1/2, and I find it quite not so good that they didn't reach RLN2 in a very good way, because if you think about it, there should also be a rest entropy at the lowest temperature, but they pinned it to zero there, and then they also overshoot it, so that is not so the best measurement here, but they kind of reached RLN2, to be honest. And then I found also in another paper a very interesting thing, and that's the μSR measurement, that I don't have many ideas about μSR, but that much I understood here in this picture. If we have a constant region, then we are not in a transition region, then we have at the right part paramagnetic, and on the left part quantum spin liquid, and you can see here something is constant here and something is constant here above 10 Kelvin, and that means that we have here is firstly a state of quantum spin liquid and there a state of paramagnetic for some reason, and then we have something like a big transition area, because if we would have antiferromagnetic behavior, then we would have a very sharp transition, but that's not the case here. We have a continuous transition, and this is also a hint that we have quantum spin liquid and not antiferromagnetic ground state here. And this is a very good thing, a very good method to see this the μSR, because it faces more the local region, and this is very obviously very good. Because the local region is completely different between quantum spin liquid and antiferromagnetic case, and you can see here this transition, so to say transition, I don't know the right word for this, in this case, and which is also a thing for the quality, but you can see that the quality of the quantum spin liquid is rather good, is that this constant value here above is 7 times higher than this constant value of the paramagnetic phase, and this is a very high number in this case, and that shows that the quantum spin liquid has a good quality, so to say, and it was the best quality found, and that's somehow a measurement for this. And this is all about sodium ytterbium sulfide, so everything says that we have a quantum spin liquid ground state here, which emerges between 800 millikelvin and 8 Kelvin. And the hints for that are basically μSR and also a specific heat that we have here, exactly at this 800 millikelvin, such a peak, which cannot be another effect or cannot be given to another effect. And then also but you can remember it, that we have this effective moment, which is then dropped. And this also hints that we have a spin state and a quantum spin liquid state. Okay, next thing is potassium cerium sulfide. And this is then, okay, I can say it because I said it in the beginning, antiferromagnetic ground state. And firstly, they did also ACS measurement, but they first didn't found any transition, because the transition was at a very low temperature. So you have to be careful if you see this. You can think, okay, no transition, maybe quantum spin liquid, but it's just until 2 Kelvin or 1 Kelvin, and that's maybe 2 Kelvin, and that's not enough. But you can see a very high anisotropy between both directions. And this is a very special case for this material. You have a high anisotropy there. And then, next picture. This is very interesting, specific heat. They did very much things about specific heat. And you can also learn things about the specific heat there, because you can see a transition. They did low temperature specific heat and found a transition, and also a transition which is dependent on the magnetic field, and it's also dependent on in-plane, different in-plane directions, as you can see here, On the left picture, we have in plane in this direction that the field connects, so to say, two of these items, and then we have here a 30 degree different field direction, and you can see in the picture we have slight differences. And which is the most interesting part is the zero Tesla without field, and this is the same basically. And here you can see that there is a transition at a temperature of 380 millikelvin, and that's also μSR confirmed, but I didn't show μSR here because I have no idea about μSR. And yeah, this is it. Here you can see the transition, and that's a clear thing. And then you can also do Schottky, because you can see here, first they extracted the magnetic part, and then they extracted this, and then with the rest they could do Schottky at higher temperatures. And there they found also a very necessary thing, the field dependency of the Schottky effect. First, at zero Tesla, they didn't found, or the peak of the Schottky was at very, very low temperatures, or just not very good foundable. But then in the 6 Tesla and 9 Tesla case, there we can see the clear Schottky peak. And for 2 niveaus, it's really easy to see the Schottky. And it's field dependent because of the Zeeman splitting. Because first, for the Schottky, we have 2 niveaus with a certain gap. And if we have an external field, then we have also a Zeeman effect and an extra Zeeman splitting, and the gap gets higher, and therefore the energy gets higher. That's clear because it's an energy diagram which I'm talking about in the NIVO schema. And in the end, the Schottky peak goes to the right because it's dependent on KT times another constant. And which is also done is the entropy, and here it reaches RLN2 very perfectly. So that's the dream case of Schottky measurements, and here also the dream case. And what you can do if we have something like that, and also with fields, we can do a phase diagram, and here they performed a phase diagram magnetic order below a certain temperature, 380, or yes, then at higher fields 500 or something like that millikelvin, and then a paramagnetic phase. And between that we have this line, and this is something a little bit strange, I would say, because of an antiferromagnet you expect the behavior that if the field is higher, then you are more likely in the paramagnet at a certain temperature, because it tends to be a ferromagnetic. So for the ferromagnetic, it's the completely different order. And then you expect a bending like here on the top, but at the bottom we have the completely different bending. But okay, that's okay, because at the frustration maybe we have some differences to the classical part. And that's very, and here you can see the full power of specific heat. With specific heat, you can do a very complete characterization of this antiferromagnet, or better to say about the transition, because you didn't characterize the antiferromagnet. And then, next experiment, the other paper, it was basically about Newton scattering, and there they could do more specific things here. They found some moments, and they also said, okay, we have something around 400 millikelvin, and then we have something like such an order parameter here. And there we have antiferromagnetism, and they also found out that it is some kind of stripe antiferromagnetism in plane. And then also something like this, but that's not so interesting here. I just showed it because I also did thermal expansions, and I wanted to show that I used a very good method to use that. But that's not so interesting in this case. So I could show you here that at potassium cerium sulfide we have antiferromagnetic ground state, and these are the two opportunities: antiferromagnetic ground state, quantum speed liquid ground state. And in the next video, I want to say something about it. What are the differences? Why are some materials in this class, and why are some materials in this class? what are the reasons for that, because I didn't mention it now. And as you can see, both is possible, and on first glance you should say, okay, that is not so a big difference between these two materials, why they are so different in their ground state. And that's the part of the next video. So bye bye and good luck for your studies. So now I have to go back and end the video.